Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. We will be discussing today the management of the bladder pain syndrome, a very important RCOG guideline. Okay, so let us study this guideline from the book. Okay, executive summary of the recommendation. First of all, we have to study the initial presentation and assessment. For that, I would like to show you the drawing which I have made. Okay, initial presentation and assessment. What initial clinical assessment should be performed? Okay, and the figure shows that the principle of management of the bladder pain syndrome should be similar to that of the chronic pain management, chronic pelvic pain or chronic whatever type of the chronic pain in the body. The principle of the management of the bladder pain syndrome should be similar to that. And another important point is that we have to take the proper history of the patient and do the proper clinical examination. So history and clinical examination both are very important. That is what written in the guideline, that what initial clinical assessment should be performed. It's written that bladder pain syndrome is a chronic pain syndrome, and the principle of the management of the chronic pain should be used for the initial assessment of this condition, and a thorough medical history should be taken and physical examination performed. Okay, thorough medical history and physical examination, those are very much important. Okay, now what baseline investigation should be performed? That is written here. What baseline investigation should be performed? I have made a bladder diary. Bladder diary has its great importance. We have to tell the patient that she has to maintain the proper bladder diary. Secondly, the food diary is also important, because there are certain type of the fluid, certain type of the food which can trigger the bladder pain syndrome. So we have to ask the patient to keep record of whatever type of the food she takes in a form of a diary, and let us know about that. Okay, and the third very important thing is about urine analysis. We have to check, we have to do the urine analysis for the patient with the bladder pain syndrome in order to rule out UTI. First of all, we need to rule out the UTI. That is very important. Okay, but in some patients we check the urine for UTI, but we don't find any sort of the UTI, but still the patient is symptomatic. Okay, but the culture shows that there is pyuria. Okay, culture and pyuria is negative, but patient is still symptomatic. So what we have to check for? In that case, we have to check for the other two important thing. First of all, urea plasma, urea lyticum, and chlamydia. Okay, these two important things needs to be checked out in the patients who are symptomatic, but the culture report is negative. So in that case, we have to check for the chlamydia and urea plasma, urea lyticum. Now, in some patients, we may suspect the malignancy. In patients with suspicion of malignancy, what we have to do when we do the urine analysis, we have to do urine cytology as well in order to check for any evidence of malignancy. And also, we have to refer the patient for cystoscopy. And if needed, depending upon the results, we have to refer the patient to the urologist. So that is what written in the guideline. Okay, it's written in the guideline what baseline investigation should be performed. Okay, a bladder diary should be completed. A food diary may be used to identify if specific food caused the flare-up of symptoms, and urine should be tested to rule out a urinary tract infection, as this is the prerequisite for the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome. And investigation of the urinary urea plasma and chlamydia may be considered in symptomatic patient with a negative urine culture and pyuria. Okay, and in those with a suspicion of urological malignancy, urine cytology should be tested, and cystoscopy and referral to the urology should be initiated in accordance with the local guideline. Okay, the next important thing which is written in this guideline is what are the differential diagnosis. Okay, differential diagnosis. Okay, in the differential diagnosis about this is written that bladder pain syndrome is in fact the diagnosis of exclusion. That is very important, and we need to rule out the other conditions. Okay, so that is what written here, that what are the differential diagnosis. Bladder pain syndrome is a diagnosis of exclusion, and other conditions should be excluded before we make the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome. Another thing is about investigations. What investigations are used to diagnose the bladder pain syndrome? Okay, investigations to diagnose. First of all, there is some role of the bladder biopsy, and hydrodistension, but it is not written that we shouldn't go straight away to the bladder biopsy and hydrodistension. The role of these two things are not recommended. Okay, next to the bladder biopsy and hydrodistension, we have the role of the cystoscopy. Okay, but cystoscopy does not confirm or exclude the diagnosis of the it doesn't give the confirmatory diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome, but it is helpful to exclude the other conditions which can mimic bladder pain syndrome. So that is very important. Okay, and also we have to know that which test should not be used in the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome. What this is written that PST, potassium sensitivity test, that should not be used for the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome. Also, the urodynamic testing, urodynamic assessment should not be done solely for the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome. And also, there is no specific role of the urinary biomarkers. Okay. But in some conditions, yes, there is a little bit role of these this urodynamic assessment. What condition? Urodynamic assessment is done, yes, in a condition when there is coexisting bladder pain syndrome and overactive bladder. We have two conditions, coexisting bladder pain syndrome and overactive bladder. If we have two of these conditions, if these two conditions coexist and the overactive bladder not responding to the treatment, then we can go for the urodynamic assessment. All these things are written in the RCOG guideline. Okay, so let's go to the guideline. Okay, guideline says that what investigations are used to diagnose the bladder pain syndrome? Bladder biopsies and hydrodistension are not recommended for the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome, as I have discussed to you. And cystoscopy does not confirm or exclude the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome, but is required to diagnose or exclude other conditions that may make the bladder pain syndrome. That's what I have discussed with you. Okay, now coming to the other points, that potassium sensitivity test. Okay, potassium sensitivity test, urodynamic assessment, and urinary biomarkers should not be used in the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome. These tests should not be used in the diagnosis of the bladder pain syndrome. However, urodynamic tests may be considered if there is coexisting bladder pain syndrome and overactive bladder and or stress urinary incontinence and or voiding dysfunction that are not responding to the treatment. Now, another important point is about the classification of severity of the bladder pain syndrome. How will we classify the severity of the bladder pain syndrome? That is by the symptom scores. There is a there must be a proper validated symptom score system. It means that we have to assess the symptoms of the patient in order to get an idea about the severity of the bladder pain syndrome. Secondly, there must be certain visual analog scales. Okay, means like, for instance, for the pain we have certain visual analog scales, we use that. So we can use these visual analog scale or validated symptom scores. Okay, that is what written in the guideline. Okay, how can we classify the severity of the bladder pain syndrome? Clinicians should use a validated symptom score to assess the baseline severity of the bladder pain syndrome and assess the response to the treatment. And the use of visual analog scales for the pain should be considered to assess the severity of the pain in bladder pain syndrome. Now, something about the effects on the quality of the lives. Okay, how does the bladder pain syndrome affects the quality of the life? It is written that the patients with the bladder pain syndrome have low self-esteem. Okay, they have low self-esteem and they have sexual dysfunction as well. Okay, and it is said that they have reduced quality of life. Okay, so these things, three things must be kept in mind: low self-esteem, sexual dysfunction, and reduced quality of life. And it is also important to keep in mind that there might be certain coexisting conditions as well which can result in the bladder pain syndrome. So now come to the guideline. What is the effect of bladder pain syndrome on the quality of the life? Patients with the bladder pain syndrome can have low self-esteem, sexual dysfunction, and reduced quality of life. This is what I have discussed with you. And patients with the bladder pain syndrome may have other coexisting conditions impacting on their quality of life. We have to keep this thing in mind. Now, how would we treat the bladder pain syndrome? First of all, let us discuss the initial treatment. Initial treatment include the conservative management. Conservative management include the dietary modifications, okay, like avoidance of alcohol, avoidance of the caffeine, and other acidic food and drinks, okay, avoidance of that type of the food should be considered. That is a very important point. The second very important thing in the management is that of the stress management. Okay, stress management may be considered. Okay, and we have to advise the patient to do regular exercises. Okay, dietary modification, stress management, regular exercises. Okay, and analgesia. There's a role of analgesia as well. Analgesia is recommended for the relief of the symptoms of the pelvic and bladder pain. Okay, and as far as the acupuncture is concerned, okay, there is limited data on the acupuncture. Okay, some like for every pain acupuncture is recommended, but there is a limited data on the efficacy of acupuncture. Otherwise, we can advise dietary modifications, stress management, exercises, and analgesics, but regarding acupuncture there is a limited data. So let us discuss the management, the guideline. What is the initial management? Initial management include conservative treatment like dietary modification can be beneficial, and avoidance of the caffeine, alcohol, and acidic foods and drinks should be considered. Stress management may be recommended, and regular exercise can be beneficial. Analgesia is recommended for the symptoms of the pelvic or the bladder pain, and there are limited data on the benefits of acupuncture. Now, after conservative management, there comes the role of pharmacological treatment. Okay, about this, it's written in the guideline that when we use the first line conservative treatment and that fails, okay, so now comes the role of pharmacological treatment. So we have to consider the role of amitriptyline and cimetidine. Okay, but about cimetidine, it's written that it is not licensed for bladder pain syndrome, so it should be used by an expert only. Now let us discuss it in the guideline. Pharmacological treatment, oral amitriptyline or cimetidine may be considered when the first line conservative treatments have failed. Cimetidine is not licensed to treat bladder pain syndrome and should only be commenced by a clinician specialized to treat this condition. Now coming to the intravesical treatment, about this it's written that when conservative and other treatments are unsuccessful, when conservative and other treatments like we have discussed amitriptyline and cimetidine, those type of the treatments are failed, then we have to consider other therapies. The other therapies are added in that case, and other therapies depend upon what? Other therapy depends upon, first of all, the expertise of the clinical team. Okay, and also depends upon the multidisciplinary team management in the specialist center. In the specialist center, we have to refer the patient to a specialist center. We have the experts who can manage the chronic pelvic pain, and there is a multidisciplinary team involved in the specialist center. So after the initial treatment gets failed, we have to refer the patients to the expert team who can involve the multidisciplinary team. So that is what written in the guideline, that if conservative and oral treatments have been unsuccessful, other therapies may be added or substituted using an individualized approach. This will depend upon the experience and expertise of the clinical team involved and the onward referral to the specialist center with expertise in the chronic pelvic pain management and access to the professional from other specialties to provide a multidisciplinary approach to care that may be appropriate. okay, and we have the different options that we can discuss. The different options include intravesical lidocaine, intravesical hyaluronic acid, injection botulinum toxin, which comes in the name of Botox, and other treatment options include intravesical dimethyl sulfur oxide, DMSO, intravesical heparin, intravesical chondroitin sulfate. Okay, so these are all written in the guideline that the different treatment options include intravesical lidocaine, intravesical hyaluronic acid, intravesical injection of botulinum toxin, Botox, intravesical dimethyl sulfur oxide, DMSO, intravesical heparin, intravesical chondroitin sulfate. Okay, for the treatment option, we have to discuss here. Okay, now come to the further treatment. Okay, about this, it's written that further treatment should be considered after referral to the pain clinic. Okay, we refer the patient to the pain clinic for the chronic pelvic pain management. And there, the treatment is decided after discussion with the multidisciplinary team. Okay, we have a pain clinic in which we do discussion with the multidisciplinary team. Okay, another type of treatment is by cystoscopy. We do cystoscopy when we have the heinous lesion in the bladder. Okay, this is the urinary bladder. Inside this, we have the specific area of inflammation in the bladder, and those specific areas of inflammation are called the heinous lesion. Okay, we have heinous lesions. We identify heinous lesion, and by using the cystoscope, we either do fulguration or the laser treatment. Okay, that is another treatment option. Okay, so what are the treatment options? We refer the patient to the pain clinic. Secondly, by using cystoscopy, we deal with the heinous lesion by method of fulguration or the laser treatment. Okay, we may consider the other treatment option in the form of neuromodulations. Neuromodulations means the nerve stimulation, and that include the posterior tibial nerve stimulation, okay, and the sacral neuromodulation. Okay, we can consider these two type of the treatment. Okay, these are considered after the conservative oral and intravesical treatments get failed. Okay, so in that case, we have to offer the neuromodulation treatment. Okay, and another important thing is that when the conservative management get fails, we can go for another line of management as well, that is the role of cyclosporin E. Cyclosporin A also has a very important role. We can consider that if the conservative oral and intravesical treatment get failed. Okay, now there is important role of cystoscopy plus minus hydrodistention. Cystoscopy with or without hydrodistention may also be considered if the conservative oral and intravesical treatment get failed. We can go in that direction as well. Okay, and sometime there is role of major surgery as well. Major surgery may be considered as the last line of treatment in case of refractory bladder pain syndrome. Okay, when the bladder pain syndrome is not responding to any sort of treatment, we can go for the major surgery. So let us discuss this further treatment from the actual guideline. Further treatment option should only be considered after referral to a pain clinic and discussion at the multidisciplinary team, as cystoscopic fulguration and laser treatment and transurethral resection of the lesion can be considered if heinous lesions are identified at cystoscopy. I have told you what the heinous lesions are. Neuromodulations or nerve stimulation in the form of posterior tibial or sacral neuromodulation may be considered after conservative oral and intravesical treatments have failed in a multidisciplinary setting. And oral cyclosporin A may be considered after conservative other oral intravesical and neuromodulation treatments have failed. Now, cystoscopy with or without hydrodistention may be considered if conservative and oral treatments have failed. Major surgery may be considered as a last treatment in a refractory bladder pain syndrome. Okay, now come to the treatments that are not recommended. Now, so far we have discussed the treatments that are recommended. So what type of the treatments are not recommended? First of all, oral hydroxyzine does not appears to be effective for hydroxyzine is not effective for bladder pain syndrome. Secondly, the Ponstan polysulfate oral, that is not considered to be effective for the bladder pain syndrome. Okay, the long-term antibiotic intravesical resin ferrotoxin is a specific type of toxin that is collected from the plant. There is a specific cactus plant from which this resin ferrotoxin is collected. The role of that is also controversial. Intravesical bacillus calmette-curing and high pressure, long-term high pressure hydrodistention and long-term oral glucocorticoids. These are all the therapies which are not recommended for the bladder pain syndrome. Let us study this from the guideline. Treatments that are not recommended: oral hydroxyzine does not appear to be an effective treatment for bladder pain syndrome. Oral Ponstan polysulfate does not appear to be an effective treatment for bladder pain syndrome. Long-term antibiotic intravesical resin ferrotoxin, intravesical bacillus calmette-curing and high pressure long duration hydrodistention and long-term oral glucocorticoids are the therapies that are not recommended for the bladder pain syndrome. Now the question arises, who should manage the bladder pain syndrome? About this, it's written that the doctors in the primary care setting should take proper history, do physical examination and do urine analysis as well. And if they fail to respond to the conservative management, then the patient should be referred to the secondary care setting. Okay, it's written in the guideline who should manage bladder pain syndrome. History, urine analysis and physical examination should be carried out in the primary care setting. And who should be referred to the secondary care? Patient who respond to the conservative treatment should be referred to secondary care. Now what is the role of the multidisciplinary team? Okay, in the multidisciplinary team we may have the group of physiotherapists. Okay, pelvic floor physiotherapy should be considered. We have to refer for psychological support. We have to refer the patient, and it's written that before neuromodulations, before we consider neuromodulation, we have to refer the patient to MDT, that is multidisciplinary team. Okay, so that is written in the guideline that what is the role of MDT, physiotherapist, pain team, clinical psychologist. Refer to the physiotherapist should be considered as bladder pain syndrome symptoms may be improved with a physical therapy, and consider referring patient with a refractory bladder pain syndrome for psychological support or counseling if it is impacting on their quality of life or the patient requests a referral. And patient with a refractory bladder pain syndrome should be referred to a multidisciplinary team in order to explore alternative treatment options, and those patients may benefit from the neuromodulations should be referred to an MDT before treatment is commenced. Okay, so before neuromodulation we have to refer for the MDT. Now what is the role of the support group? About this, it's written that patient should be given written information about patient organization that provide evidence-based information. Okay, now long-term management. Okay, and what should be the duration of the follow-up? Okay, and about this, it's written that patient should be followed up periodically in the secondary care setting for the shared care between the pain team and urogynecology team. So we have to discuss these things. What is the role of support group? Patient should be given written information about patient organization that provide evidence-based information, and long-term management and prognosis. Okay, what should be the duration of follow-up? Patient should be followed up periodically in the secondary care setting with a consideration for the shared care between the pain team and urogynecology until the symptoms become controlled, and then they can be followed up in the primary care if required. Now come to the last point, bladder pain syndrome and pregnancy. And patient should be advised that he effect of the symptom of the bladder pain syndrome can be variable, and we can consider the options like intravesical heparin or oral amitriptyline, and DMSO used prior to the pregnancy for the symptoms remissions. So, bladder pain syndrome and pregnancy is the last point written in this guideline. Women can be advised that the effect of the pregnancy on the severity of the bladder pain syndrome can be variable. Okay, and bladder pain syndrome treatment option is considered safe in pregnancy, including oral amitriptyline and intravesical heparin. Both of these things are safe in pregnancy. Although one course of DMSO may be used prior to the pregnancy for the symptoms remission with a good pregnancy outcome, like delivery at term, normal birth weight, and postnatal symptoms control, DMSO is known to be teratogenic in animal studies. So DMSO can be used prior to pregnancy for the symptoms remission, but it has been found to be teratogenic in origin. Okay, so that was all about the RCG guideline about the bladder pain syndrome. Thank you so much for your kind listening.